In this video, we begin our exploration of the exponential function and its use in circuits. We'll talk a little bit about where it's found in nature and some of its general properties. In nature, it's found in damped dynamic systems, and we of course see it in circuits. And it has some very remarkable properties that we can discover by looking at series expansions for its small argument expressions and so forth. But the most remarkable thing about the exponential function is that it is its own derivative. On the right is a little figure showing that an exponential function can show both growth and decay. In most applications it will be interested in, it will be decay, with at least one notable exception. So some examples of damped systems. Any system, any dynamic system with friction. That can be surface friction, either dry friction, just two surfaces sliding against one another. They can be lubricated and so forth. There can be fluids flowing on surfaces. Skin friction can be, like, for example, the friction that exists around the airfoil in an airplane. There's also internal friction as things go through a material of some kind, and that, you know, a permeable medium where things might flow through it, but they're slowed down by friction. There's also static versus kinetic, which you can see in the pictures on the right. We run into all the time in automobiles. If your wheels are spinning, you're under dynamic conditions when the wheel is stationary with respect to the surface that you're riding on, then that's static friction. Resistance is a model that we use in electrical systems, but also in thermal systems. It's common to characterize the ability of a material to resist the heat flow from one region to another as thermal resistance. So this exponential functions will show up in all of these circumstances. So it's a very important type of mathematical expression to get to understand well. And as we'll see in electrical and computer engineering, it's used in so many places it's actually hard to count. What does it look like? This is an exponential function, which is just e to the x. Now with x going in this direction, whenever x is positive, the function grows, as you would expect from any sort of an exponent. And whenever it's negative, then you basically have the same thing as e to the minus x in the negative direction with the magnitude around it. And so as the variable x gets larger, e to the minus x gets smaller. This is what a growing function would look like. But in fact, what we will see most of the time, as I've indicated, is damping is the important thing. And we will basically see it turned around like this, where it's decaying. So it looks exactly the same. It just goes in the other direction. So it looks more like this kind of a function here. OK, so before we move on, we have to actually remind ourselves about what the derivative of the function is, and some examples. And if we have any kind of a function like this, locally some line that's tangent to it, the slope of that line is the derivative of the function at that point. And we represent the derivative, say with respect to x, by d dx of some function of x like this. And as examples, there's a page that I can take you to in a second and shows you some of the most common functions, mathematical functions, that people have worked out in great detail what the derivatives are so that we can more easily evaluate them. But in terms of what a derivative of the function is, I have a link here to the Wikipedia page, which we'll go to in a second. So here's the Wikipedia page on the derivative, and you can see on the right here is what I indicated previously, that this line, this tangent line, is what the derivative is equal to. And if you try to figure out what the slope in that line is, there is a little discussion of finding that slope. And then we take a limit as we make the distance that we're going over really, really small, and that gives us the derivative. There's a lot of other information information here, and it's worth the glance through it and remind you what you may have learned in calculus or pre-calculus. And this is another web page under the mathisfun.com site, which shows some common derivatives. The derivative of a constant is zero because it doesn't have a slope, it's just flat. Derivative of x is 1, the derivative of x squared is 2x, and so forth. And here's the really remarkable one we're going to be working with. That is the exponential e to the x, its derivative is e to the x. There's also logarithms and trig functions and so forth. All of these things, pretty much all the things on this list up here, are things that you should know how to use. You shouldn't necessarily have them memorized. Memorized is good, but it's not essential. Okay, and again, these are the two websites that I just showed you. One is the Math is Fun page, and the other is the Wikipedia entry on the derivative. Okay, so exponential function. There's a lot of information, again, on the Wikipedia page on the exponential function, and much of the important information I've actually copied onto these slides. I've included the link up here, so if you look at the original slides, you'll actually see a link to that website. The exponential function can be written as a series expansion as the sum of an infinite number of terms from n equals 0 to infinity of x to the n over n factorial, which is written out as shown to the right. There's actually a bunch of other representations of this too, but this is the one we want to use right now, and why I reminded you of the derivative of some simple functions. Okay, so this representation allows us to show why the derivative is equal to itself. So here's the derivative expression, here's the derivative of the series expansion, which is the same thing that's up here. And when I take the derivative of 1, I get 0, the derivative of x, I get 1, the derivative of x squared, I get 2x, and so forth. And as I combine this all back together again, you discover that it adds up to be e again, e to the x. So clearly, it's its own derivative. We're going to be using the series expansion to develop some other properties of the exponential, which are also used almost by every single electrical engineer and often most computer engineers every single day. More generally, we don't always find it in this form. We actually find it in something like e to the minus ax or something, ax or something like that. So it's really more like e to the function of x, where we have some kind of a constant up here. And in order to do that, whenever you have the derivative of a function of some argument that's also a function, you have to take the derivative of the argument also. This is the derivative of the argument, and then times e to the f of x. That's the more general way of doing it, and the form that we'll actually see, and I'll ask you to do this in the experiment for the class. Small argument expression. These are incredibly important and incredibly useful. Because we have this great big long series expansion, if this number x is really, really small, then x squared is over 2 is much, much smaller than x, and this is even smaller yet, and so forth. So under the right conditions where it's really small, we just neglect all those things and just keep the first two terms. And in fact, e to the x is approximately equal to 1 plus x. You can also just show this by evaluating e to the x with your calculator and comparing it to 1 plus x. The final kind of thing that we need to worry about here with regards to the exponential is that there are some characteristic times and distances. As far as the distances go, when we have an e to the minus ax, which I wrote badly on a previous slide, can also be written as e to the minus x over d, where d is a characteristic distance. In fact, that's the distance where the function decays to 1 over e, because if you put x over d, that's going to be equal to 1. So the expression becomes e to the minus 1, or just basically 1 over e. E is 2.71828, so it's a similar number to a third, a little bit bigger. Exponential time, often written as e to the minus alpha t or something like that. And we can write that as e to the minus t over tau, where tau is the characteristic time. This is the time constant. Okay, and for RC circuits, something we've already seen a little bit, the time constant is R times C. For RL circuits, tau is equal to L over R. If you're interested, you may wonder why R shows up in the numerator in one case and the denominator in the other case. And there's actually a fairly nice discussion of this on the website All About Circuits. And if you just actually, in fact, if you just Google YLR and not LR, it's supposed to be written as Y is it L over R and not R times L as it isn't R times C. That actually explains why this is, because the energy in one case is stored in the voltage and the energy in the other case is stored in the current. Okay. One more slide. All right, so we have all these things that happen with respect to space and time, where if we have, you know, one temperature in one region over here and a temperature in another region over here, and the temperature, if the T1 is greater than T2, we actually see this exponential decay in temperature through an insulator. And so the insulator, so the temperature on one side can be quite a bit different than the temperature on the other side. We also have things like voltages that decay as a function of time. Now, you see that the exponential function, which goes as e to the minus something times t, never really gets to zero. It just keeps getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. So if the function decays for all time, it actually has a value at t equals infinity. Does the quantity it represents really never go to zero? Well, of course, from a practical engineering point of view, of course it goes to zero. Or it gets so small we don't care about it anymore. So we always have to decide what is zero. So once it decays down to say like 5% or something like that, we might say it's effectively at zero. With very little energy left in a capacitor whose voltage has dropped from 100% down to 5%. If you want to be a little bit more of a stickler about these things, you can say 1%. And then finally what happens is when the voltage gets really, really small, or when the something is like, let's say this was like the speed of, or the position of something, and it's stopping due to friction. Does it actually ever stop? Well, what happens is when it gets going slowly enough, eventually what was kinetic friction turns into static friction, and it just gets stuck and immediately stops. So it comes down to some level and then drops all the way to zero. So there are times when it does indeed go to zero because the physics changes. In other cases, it just gets really small and we don't care about it anymore. So there's the practical engineering solution, which says it's small enough to neglect. And then there's the physics zero, which says, well, eventually it hits something, the physics changes, and it comes to a stop. You may have noticed this when you're sliding along on something. You'll slide for a while, and then all of a sudden you catch on something and indeed come to a full stop. So it's good to think about these things. Mathematically, we have a function that exists for all space or all time, but practically speaking, it gets to zero pretty quickly. A good rule of thumb is that if we look at these characteristic lengths, if we go to like three time constants, we'll be down to about 5% of the value. And at 5%, it no longer probably matters very much. If you really need it to get to be smaller yet, then a few more e-foldings, 6-7 e-foldings, and you're definitely down so far that you can't actually tell that there's anything there at all. An e-folding is a length when it, or a time when it, time equal to tau, or a distance where it drops to 1 over e of its previous value. And that's basically it about the exponential function, which we'll be exploring much more in an actual circuits context in the experiment we're doing in class. And we'll see you there.